Hello everyone. Today I'm going to talk about the foundations of artificial neural networks. I'm going to discuss linear discriminants, and I'm also going to show a little bit how a neuron or a perceptron works. For this purpose, I made a poster which will be available on my homepage and where you can download it. And in this poster, you already see how an artificial neural network can be seen as a function, how it can then learn using a learning algorithm. We will have also some code snippets implemented in Python in order to give you the idea how it works. And we will be explaining every part of it with numbers, so you have exactly an idea how it works under the hood. And we have also, of course, some nice visualization of artificial neural networks, in this case only of a neuron. So let's jump to it. So brain is the best learning system. And what I want to say is that artificial neural networks were inspired by the functionality of human brain. And the thing what makes it so powerful is the sheer number of neurons and synapses. So this is the true power of artificial neural networks, or of a brain from which artificial neural networks were inspired. So imagine this concrete scenario. You have a list, a data, where you have a square meter of a house and the price for this house. So imagine for a house of 20 square meters, you pay 400,000 euros. And for 40 square meters apartment, you pay 80,000 euros. And for 60, 120,000, for 80 square meters, you pay 160,000. So imagine you have to find the price of a house for 50 square meters. And this example is very easy, and it gives you already an intuition how human beings would do it. You know already the solution. And of course, we can see the problem as a function. We can see the problem as a linear function. And here you have a very clear geometric solution. If you look at it, you need just to find the place where 50 square meter is, and you immediately know the price of it. There is some relationship between the square meters and the price of the house. And in this case, because it's a simple example which was invented by me, there is a very beautiful linear relationship. So let's see it from calculation point of view. So as I mentioned, the thing what we are going to do, or what we wanna do, is a simple function. It's a linear function. X would be our input. Weight is actually the changing rate of our function. So you can imagine it in this way. And immediately also, intuitively, you get a feeling for that. Square meter of a house has to be for 2000 euro. And if you find this weight, you can calculate it for any price, for any x you put. If you put here 50 square meter, then you get 100,000 euros. This can be done analytically, but in the real life, unfortunately, the numbers or the relationship is not that clear. So that's why you need to find the V by guessing it, or algorithmically, and not directly analytically. So, and this is what I'm going to show you. And in the statistics in the mathematics, it's also known as linear, or as foundation for a linear regression. And if we would apply it to our artificial neural network scheme, then we would have only two neurons. One is input neuron, another one is output neuron, and it's connected to each other by the weight. Weight would be here about 2,000 euros. Yeah, and you put any x here, xi, and it actually predicts how much it's going to be. So this is just a very simple, very basic building block of a brain or artificial neural network. So you can imagine in real life an artificial network looks much complicated. So if we would design an algorithm for that, for training an algorithm in order to find the weight, what would we need? So we need a set of inputs, x in our case, it would be 20, 40, 60, 80. So this is xi. We need a weight, which we don't know what value it has yet. We need a set of targets or labels, and this is 40, 80, 20, 120 and 160. And note that we omitted the last three zeros in order to be it easily readable. We need a learning rate in order not to change our learning too fast. So this is a small number, and I will explain it later on what this number does. And we need, of course, a number of iteration to update our weight. This number is called epochs. So these are our variables we need, and we need, of course, also to do something. So the algorithm needs to initialize v with any random number. So in the beginning, it doesn't matter which number it is. We calculate or compute a prediction, as I showed before, with y. The function of yx is equal to a weight times xi, and the output will be put into hi variable. And now this is the heart of the algorithm. What we're going to do is to predict or to compute the error of the prediction. So this is also called sometimes error function, and see how different the output is from the desired target or desired label. So this is done here in this section. And imagine if our age that what we predicted would be very close to t, then the error function has a very low value, and we if we update our weight, it doesn't change that much. But in the beginning, if there is a big difference, our algorithm is going to update, to adjust. And I will show you a concrete example how it happens. And what we do after we find, so here, the most important thing is to find the difference between the target and the actual value we got from our prediction. Of course, we multiply it with eta and with xi. With eta, we multiply it in order to the algorithm not to behave too hectically, and update the value in small steps. And as we see here, the update of the weight happens by adding the new delta W value to the old weight value. So how we would implement this algorithm in Python? This is the full implementation of it. I put the number of epochs to 26. The weight was randomly initialized by me. I put the value 0.5. And what we do, we just iterate for each epoch, and then we iterate over our Actually over four, because we have four values, but yeah, we iterate actually over our input and inputs and targets, and for each input here, this would be xi, we calculate the age, and then we will the code will spit out what the prediction is, what the target is, what is the difference. And then we will, this is again the heart of the algorithm, when we will update actually our weight, and then we will see the new weight. So what happens if we run this algorithm? If we run this algorithm in the epoch zero, it already finds what the prediction is. It is 10 because we initialized the v value with 0.5. So, but the target is 40, so the difference is 30, so it needs to be updated. So yeah, so you see the new weight increases, so it's 0.512. So, and it happens actually for every xi, so for every instance in the input, and you see our weight increases slowly till 0.8. And then let's jump to the last epochs. So as you see, it increased a lot, and then it reaches a certain point, and here the difference, the error function is so low that the new weight does not increase too much. So it's very close to 2, and this is the value we wanted to have. Remember, a square meter is for 2000 euros. So this is should be the last epoch, and as you see, it's very close to 2, and here we can stop. So yeah, this is one way of doing it. So what happens actually, or what you would encounter when you would read papers about deep learning, that you will see much of the things is done by using linear algebra. So this is in principle putting the weights and input values into vectors and matrices. So in this example, we will use only the vectors. And it has lots of advantages why you can do it, or why one should do it. So it's easier to read, it's easier to handle, and it's actually faster from runtime point of view, because if you have vectors, you can parallelly compute much faster than in every for loop, as in the example I showed you before. You can use also some libraries for linear algebra, like NumPy or Java library in the array, or many others. So what we have here, we have scalar. Scalar is just a number, just a number variable, and scalars are denoted with a lowercase italic letters. Then we have vectors. Vectors are an array of numbers, and they are denoted with lowercase bold italic letters. And then we have matrices, and they are denoted with uppercase bold italic letters. So our equation for prediction changes to what? Bold age, bold italic age. V is still similar because it's just one number, and bold x, because x in our case is again a vector or an array of number, it's xi, because we have four inputs. And so our equation to train changes also to this one. And if you wanna learn more about it, look just into basics of linear algebra. So, but yeah, what I wanted to do also to give you a concrete example, how does it look like? And it's actually absolutely similar to the code or to the case we have seen before. So if you want to predict vector age, you use just you multiply your scalar w with your vector x, and in our case x as you remember was 20, 40, 60, 80 square meters. And let's assume our weight is 1.5. Then age is 1.5 times 20, 40, 60, 80. So it's like 30, 60, 90, 120. So the multiplying a vector a scalar with a vector, you multiply just each number in the vector with a scalar. So, and difference is also very easily computed. This is 10, 20, 30, 40. And now we can compute our error function, you know, by multiplying our learning rate in order to get smaller numbers, and again with x. So, and at the end, we multiply to vectors, and when you multiply to vectors, you can get a number back, a scalar. So, and the multiplication actually happens like this. You multiply the first number in the vector with the first number of another vector, and then add the values together. So our updating weight in when our weight was 1.5 would be this, and it would increase to 1.62. So this would happen also in our previous case with for loop, but this would happen when we would implement the algorithm with the help of linear algebra library. Here we use the dot function from NumPy, and as you see, we by using it we avoided one for loop where we iterate over the inputs and targets, but other than that, the behavior of this algorithm is absolutely the same as to the previous one I showed you before. So this is what I have shown you so far is the basics for artificial neural networks, and you will hear or read many of this terminology I talked about, but it was nothing near to a neuron or to a fully implemented artificial network. So let's look at a more real example of a neuron, and here we have some additional stuff which makes actually the artificial neural networks very powerful. So here we have our inputs, our xi's, and we have the weights, and we have in between a sum function, and our output is not just only a number, but instead of it we put a function in between which is also called activation function. So here we see we have more number of x's inputs and more number of weights, and what I showed you before was just one of it. So this is actually not our x, but this are additional dimensions or additional vector information. So here would go the price of the house, and maybe here the location of the house, the place. So this are additional information to it. So, but the algorithm, the calculation is very similar. So we have, again, a neuron has a set of inputs. It has a set of weighted synapses or weights. It has an adder or a sum function. It has also an activation function. And here we use a step activation function, which fires if a certain threshold is achieved, and not if it's not achieved. So this threshold is denoted with theta, and the prediction is again just a sum of weights multiplied with x. So if we would have, for example, three inputs, 1, 0, 1, and three weights, then our very simplest implementation would look like this. But this is again just